spirit move me. I wanna know you more. Move all over my life. Spirit move me. Spirit teach me. Spirit move me. Spirit lead me. I wanna know you more in my life. Spirit move me, Spirit teach me, Spirit lead me, Spirit move me. I wanna know you more in my life. Spirit move me, Spirit teach me, Spirit lead me, Spirit move me. Yeah, I wanna know you more in my life. You want me to go. I'm your disciple. I'm your disciple. Move me, Spirit. All over my life. Move, Spirit. Spirit, move. Move, Spirit. Move in my life. All over my life, move in my life. Lead me, teach me. I need your guidance. I'm lost without you. Spirit, move me. Spirit, teach me. Spirit, lead me. I wanna know you more. Spirit, move me. Spirit, teach me. Spirit, lead me. I wanna know you more, yeah. More in my life, in my life, in my life. Spirit, move me. Spirit, teach me. Spirit, lead me. I wanna know you more, God, man. In my life, in my life. Teach me, Spirit, move me to higher heights of the Spirit. Move me with the pace of your Spirit, oh yeah. Spirit, move me, Spirit, teach me, Spirit, lead me. I wanna know you more. I wanna know you more. I wanna move by you, be led by you, in everything I do. disciple, I'm your disciple. Spirit, lead me.
Your business to the next level? Advertise with Radio East River by emailing us at admin@radioeastriver.co.za.
Well, good morning to all our Facebook viewers there, wherever you are, and those on TikTok. I am Dr. Graham Albertain, and we are back on the couch with Doc. And today we are going to explore the rich tapestry of history and culture in South Africa, and especially the Western Cape. I'm your host, and today we're delving into the fascinating world of the Khoisan people. We'll uncover the origin, the story of Grotua, the various tribes within the Khoisan community, and the depth of their culture and language. So yes, it is a bumper program. It is Heritage Month, and we, in the second segment of heritage last week, we look at the psychology of heritage, why heritage is important. And today we venture a little bit deeper into our culture and our origin, where we come from, who is the father or who is the mother, the actual mother of the nation. And we have none other in our studio this morning, and with me, none other. You can see the Khoisan Queen is here. None other than Jennifer Visser Spannenberg.
Stellenberg.
She is here in the studio with me, and I'm going to ask her to greet the people in the Khoisan language, and then we'll take it from there. Jennifer, over to you.
That's good morning, everybody.
Oh my, just listen to that. I won't even go and try. I will sit with Jennifer for more than 50 hours just to learn Khoisan language. For me, Dumelang Bukhaitsu, Dumelang Ra, good morning, Goeiemore, Molo Kunjani. Yes, that's where I would go. But as far as this is concerned, the language of the Khoisan people, yes, I will have to really sit down and learn it this morning. Jennifer, welcome. It's a privilege once again to have you back on a previous program in Women's Month. We had Jennifer on here, and she told us her story from the ministry to politics to wherever. And yes, now she's back as the Khoisan Queen, and she's going to tell us more about our Khoisan history. And it is important for us. Very much so. I must say, Jennifer, when I started preparing myself for this program, I suddenly realized that, yes, we went on tours with the school, primary school, to the museum. And as kids, we laughed at the Bushmen and all of that. Little did we know, they are actually our ancestors. Mm. They are actually the people where we hail from.
Oh, yes.
They are actually the people that has the fundamental, and yeah, I want to say, politically, people can differ from me. But as far as history is concerned, and people don't bring out the fundamental history of the South African nation. And here is, in my research and my preparation, I suddenly realized that we were misled as far as the actual founders or the ground, the foundation of the South African history and nation and the birth of the nation as such. And we are mixing it with other stuff and we are we actually not coming to the to the real fundamentals of the South African history. Everyone wants to speak about settlers and so on and so forth. But who are the people that really founded, if I can call it that, who are really the children of the soil of South and Southern Africa? And we really need to dig deep in that and bring out this fundamental history. But we are going to go into that. Can you see? I am learned as far as this is concerned. So we will go on to a music break. And the music comes from the Namakwa era and area. And it comes from children from the Khoisan people. And none other than Pieter van der Westhuizen is going to sing to us throughout the program. And his first song, and it is Afrikaans, the Afrikaans songs that we're bringing out, Visagentes Day. So let's take a listen to Pieter van der Westhuizen, Visagent. I must say it the way he sings it, Visagentes Day.
Hey, Mr. Brown, feeling down? Listen to the leading internet radio station in Cape Town. Verpletter plezier, luister naar Radio Eerste Rivier. Dis ons stasie, ons talent en julle bly lekker, onze mensen.
Wat my so verlei, weet jou ma van jou, wat so aan my klo, het jy jou pa gevra, of jy mag ringe dra, jou neusie is nog nat, en jy wil aan my kom vat, laat staan toch net jou stuitigheid, die soek na moeligheid, laat staan toch net jou stuitigheid, die soek na moeligheid. Laat staan toch net je stuitigheid, je zoekt naar moeligheid. Kan jij knie ook kind? Jij draait dan nog een lint, ik is een korrelkop, jij zal maar voor mij moet hop. Zal ik of zal ik niet, eerst kijk je toe feikie, ik kan toch niet zo blij, te lekker om te vrij. Laat staan toch net je stuitigheid, je zoekt naar moeligheid. Laat staan toch net je stuitigheid, je zoekt naar moeligheid. Laat staan toch net je stuitigheid, je zoekt naar moeligheid. sê kind is jy, wat my so verlei, weet jou ma van jou, wat so aan my klo. Het jy jou pa gevra, jy mag ringe dra, jou nusie is nog nat, en jy wil aan my kom vat, laat staan toch net jou stuurtigheid, jy soek na molligheid, laat staan toch net jou stuurtigheid, jy soek na molligheid, laat staan toch net jou stuurtigheid, jy soek na molligheid. Die rara rei, die rara rei, dori rori ra.
The Butcher's Market, looking for incredible value? Explore our fantastic range of products here at TBM at Sanbury Square on the corners of Baden-Powell Drive and Old Forty Road for your halal meats.
Yes,
our station, our talent, our people.
Die ding Rikki.
Yes, you are back on the couch with Doc. I'm Dr. Graham Albertine, and my guest today in the studio is none other than Jennifer Visser Spannenberg. Stallenberg. I keep on saying Spannenberg because maybe I'm gespanne here in the studio this morning with the Khoisan Queen. So, yes, and the music, Pieter van der Westhuizen sang to us, Wie se kind is jy? And that's a question to be asked, eh? Wie se kind is jy nou eindelijk? Mm. Waar is jy, waar kom jy nou eindelijk vandaan? And this morning we're going to explore that question that Pieter van der Westhuizen asked this morning, Wie se kind is jy nou eindelijk? Waar kom jy vandaan? So, yes, the Khoisan. This morning, we do it under the banner of heritage according to the Khoisan. So, start to explore this phenomena, somewhat undercover, hidden away, I don't know how I can explain it, somewhere in a cave, they just, it's not being brought to the fore, to its rightful place. All other nations or tribes or communities in South Africa, we have 11 official languages. We have subsequently 11 types of tribes in South Africa, the Xhosa, the Zulu, the people from Venda, the Tswana, the Sepedi, and so on. We have different tribes in South Africa, and who are being acknowledged, rightfully acknowledged, and everyone wants to stake a claim to say, we are the rightful owners of South Africa. But this morning we're going to explore who are the rightful owners of Southern Africa. And we're going to look at that. So, as I said, I have Jennifer that is in the studio with me, and we're going to explore. Let me ask her the first question. The Khoisan. Jennifer, where do they fit in to the South African heritage? As it is Heritage Month, this is all that we speak about.
Okay, Gangan Doc.
Gangan.
Okay, Gangan. Yes, South Africans need to understand one thing. All the other nations or what? Tribes, there's dates documented. They came, the Xhosas came that day, the Sotus, the Tswanas, everyone. But the Khoisan people were in South Africa. They were found here. They didn't come from any other neighboring countries. They were in South Africa. When Jan van Riebeeck and his team came.
1652, that is now the popular date.
Oh, yes.
Where people say the settlers came. Mm.
Yes, they found the Khoisan people here. Remember Cape Town?
Yes.
Was actually the home of the Khoisan people. And the Khoisan people were chased into the inland by the white people. By then, the Jan van Riebeeck and so. But not before they stole a lot of things from the Khoisan people.
Yes, yes.
Remember, the Khoisan people had cattle, they had lots of knowledge, they knew the land. And they are, the Khoisan people are people from the soil of this earth.
Yes,
so
yes.
So everything they knew, or they taught themselves. They were not taught by any other person. So they actually taught the white people when they came to South Africa a lot of things. They taught them, yes, they came with their medicines, but the medicines that the Khoisan grew, the medicines, they actually, let me not say, they knew the medicines, where to find which medicine. They will climb up into the mountains to get certain things. And for every sickness, they had cures. Even before the white people came, the Dutch, whatever, came to South Africa, they knew everything.
Can I come in there? Today we you speak about medicine and so on. Today we make so much of your Lennon Dutch medicine. Mm. But it's in fact the Khoisan people,
yes,
that had the natural remedy,
yes,
the herb and the plants and the barks and so on for every
sickness,
illness,
everything under the sun.
Yes,
they had. Yes, so in fact the name Khoisan.
Yes.
It's put together by two names, the Khoi and the Sen. But all the other Khoisan people, like the Griqua, the Nama,
yes,
the Kurana, the Khoi, the Sen, as well as the Bushmen,
yes,
they all fall under that umbrella called Khoisan. The Khoisan, it's an umbrella for all the other Khoisan tribes, or
yes,
let me say, clans, whatever you call them.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is how the name came about, Khoisan.
Yes.
The Khois, it's actually, they were on their own, the San were on their own,
yeah,
but
yeah,
that is how the Khoisan name came together. So it's the umbrella for all these other clans.
Yes.
And then the Khoisan people, because they learned so much from the animals, they believed that the animals could speak. And the language, the Khoi language, according to our ancestors, the Khoi language came forth from the animal languages that they spoke according to them.
Mm-hmm.
So if you listen to the Khoi speaking, it's clicks. Ne? There's a lot of clicks.
Yes,
now,
yes,
if you look into the history, the Xhosa people have also clicks, but they only borrowed three of our four clicks. We have four clicks. So the Xhosa people borrowed three of our clicks, and later on, they made it their own. As a matter of fact, It was borrowed from us. A lot of our history, the Khoisan history, not just the Xhosas, the Sotus, the Zulus, they borrowed our history.
Mm.
There's also the Lobola issue, where remember when we grew up, we thought niemand ons klierlinge,
yeah,
voor Lobola betaal.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you go into our history, Lobola was first paid by the Khoisan people. And
sure.
Yes, and it was like when a young man come into your house, you have a young daughter, and he sees, or say he knows about your daughter,
uh-huh,
then he come to visit. But in those days, he will not speak to either you or the mother or even the daughter in front of you. Then he'll watch. When the daughter goes to bed at night, he'll watch where she is. He'll slip into a room, speak to her, and when they agree, the next morning early, when the parents wake up, the guy is gone. Then he comes back with his father. Now, in today's day, the Sotho's and Tswana's call it bulamulom. I don't know how the Xhosa call it. That means before you ask for permission to speak, you need to put something on the table.
Sure.
Now, that was the koisen. The people, the guy and his father or uncles must put something on the table first before the father of the bride, so a bride-to-be, can agree to speak to them. He'll just look at them. If he's not happy with what they put on the table, the amount or whatever, he's not going to speak.
Yeah.
So only when he sees right, I want, okay, this is fine. If it's money, it's fine. If it's whatever they put on the table,
when
he agrees, then he'll just not, and then the conversation start.
Okay.
Then they'll start with negotiations, but not the marriage. Because he need to come, that you call in Tswana bulamulom.
Yeah.
But now he needs to come back for the Labola negotiations. And now what's interesting, with the Khoi people, if the father don't have, say if the bride's father wants 10 cattle, and this father of this young man only have 2, then this young man had to go to the uncles, to the grandfathers, to whomever, to borrow from them.
Sure.
Cattle, just to make up. To make up
the 10.
For the bride's price that the parents want.
What an interesting start to this program. And I want to say to you, as Jennifer said, and again, I want to look at the Khoisan people in my research. I also detected, and I said to myself, my goodness, if you look at the Khoi Khoi, that is now the Khoi people on the one side, and then the Bushmen on the other side, or the San people are often referred to as Bushmen. And you look at their lifestyle. The Khoi Khoi people were pastoralites who engaged in cattle herding.
Yes.
Yeah? They that's the way they lived and they lived in more settled communities. Mm. Whereas the Bushmen were hunter gatherers. Mm. They were hunters. Mm. And also nomadic, and they also hunt game and For also for plants.
Mm. Mm.
So I look at them, I say to myself, you have in the Khoisan, the Khoi Khoi, and in the San people, you have a type of Cain, Abel and Cain scenario.
Mm.
I think we will later, when we unpack this whole thing, you will understand why I say they have a type of Abel, who was a cattle farmer. He had cattle. And a Cain, who lived from the soil, which means from plants. Mm. He was again a farmer. But on the other hand, also looking at the Khoisan people and the way they spoke, but also in the way they communicated was, in a way, an Egyptian prehistoric type of
dialect.
Mm. Because they painted, did rock art, and they would tell their story with regards to, I mean, on a rock with painting, there were 3 men and there were so many cattle and this is what happened there, etc., etc. And if it's someone was hunting, they would draw it on a rock. Mm. And that is why we have these rock art and rock paintings today.
Mm.
So, in essence, we read in the Bible as to, and we see in the hieroglyphics, that is the way people communicated in the prehistoric, the Old Testament times. And we can say that is thousands of years. And that is on the same level, I put them on the same level as the Egyptians and the prehistoric Israelites. So where does anybody else come from? If we can call it that. So we need to understand that the Khoisan people are believed to be among the earliest inhabitants of southern Africa, with archaeological evidence suggesting their presence as far back as, some say, 20,000 years. Yes. Others say between 50,000 and 100,000 years. So those, that can be said that they were the first people in South Africa.
Yes.
They were the inhabitants of southern Africa. And no one else.
No one else.
Let's put the record straight today.
No one else.
No one else.
As we said, all the others, there are documents that prove they came at certain dates to South Africa.
Yes, yes.
Which means they were not here. But the Khoisan people came from nowhere. They were here. They are from the soil of South Africa.
Yes. So effectively, South Africa belonging to
The Khoisan people. Yes, absolutely.
And that is a fundamental fact documented, and we'll hear now as we're going to unpack more. But it's a fundamental fact, and I think all of our people need to understand that. We need to teach our children that, so that they can take it forward. This is Heritage Month. Yes. And right in the beginning, we said the psychology of heritage is that you need to tell the story to your children so that they can tell it to their children.
Absolutely.
No one else will know the story unless we tell the story. And we need to go and look at where we come from. We will go and to a music break as we're going to unpack further this interesting and exciting topic today, heritage according to the Khoisan. And we will go to a music break as I greet Bell J. Good morning, Dr. Telen. Guest, yes, Pastor Clayton. Good morning, Doc. And guest also, Desiree Damas, that's watching. Thank you for tuning in. We love it. Tell us where you calling in from and where you're watching from. Pastor Clayton say, looking forward to an impactful show. Thank you, sir. We are doing our best, and I hope that this program is going to open a lot of eyes and hearts and to warm up against towards our ancestry, the Khoisan people. Let's go on to a music break. Peter van der Westhuizen is going to sing to us, Soot Manna Soot. So yes, you better watch out. It's coming.
Hierdie week vir Wiele Twee Wiele gaan rits ek rond met die nuwe Ford Tourneo bussie. En dan beweeg ons oor na ons eerste padtoets en dit is met die Citroen C3 e-cross. Dan oor na ons tweede padtoets en dis met die Mazda CX-60, maar spesifiek daai 3.3 liter diesel. Maar dan julle vir twee wiele.
Dit is nou die BMW GS-Driver wat in die gang is en ek ry met die selde fiets, die GS-1300.
En dit is alles waarna jy kan uitsien tydens Wiele Twee Wiele, maar tot dan toe.
Hou daai wiele aan die
Soot Manna Soot, Soot Manna Soot, Soot Manna Soot, daar kom ons boot, hier kom my voet. Jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, o Willem Ros, van vye bos.
Daai lekker vry, hy wil vir my, vir hom sal ek moet kry. Ons is toe voort na Hanse boord, so vry en onverstoord. Jan kom toe saam op koos en vaan, maar Willem bly nie staan. Toe ons weer kyk, toe reik ons lyk, want Hans het opgeduid. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, kom een fout. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, kom een fout. Ons het weggehol, want Hans was vol, bij mij kon niemand tol. Jij greep me hier, jij greep me daar, vir my maak jy nie klaar. Ek spiet ou gat in eerste rat, aan my laat ek nie vat. Ek is jou krank of Willem mank, jou ma sal jy verlang. Jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los of Willem ros van vye bos. Jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los o Willem Ros van vye bos. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, ek kom my fout. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, ek kom my fout. Jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, o Willem Ros van vye bos. Jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, jy kan maar los, o Willem Ros van vye bos. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, jy kom my fout. Soutman is soud, soutman is soud, soutman is soud, daar kom ons boot, hier kom my fout.
Ya, Molweni makhaya, singu Radio East River, sifumaneka kuzo zonke social media platforms.
Radio East River, Radio East River, Radio East River, Radio East River.
Yes, you are back on the couch with Doc. It's Dr. Graham Albertain, and it's Heritage Month, and we are talking everything heritage today, and we are opening up that oyster shell from deep in the ocean today and bringing to you the real facts about who the First Nation is that South Africa actually belonged to from the heritage point of view. It is time that we understand, and it is time that we rise and celebrate our own heritage and really come to the fore and stake the claim that this is our land. It is our, it's part of our history. It's part of our heritage. And that is what we need to do. Aletta Boerstander, good morning to you. Good morning, Jen and Doc. Baie trots op jou, Sasa. Sê sy volgend. Ja, nee, wat? Ja, nee. Kijk, die mense is trots. Die mense is trots. So, yes, we are exploring. I still have Jennifer in the studio with me. And we are looking to explore further. Jennifer, many historians speaks of about Grotua. Myself only found out about this a couple of years ago. And in my research, in preparing for the program, I got another glimpse of this woman. And I spoke to someone now the other day, And I think let me keep my what I said about her for myself. Let me ask you, who was this woman and what was her significance? You know, my eyes went wide open. I got a new perspective for this and respect for this woman. But Jennifer, tell us, who is she?
Okay. Doc, Krutua, we see Krutua as the mother of our nation.
Yes.
Krutua was a little girl. She was the niece to Chief, I want to pronounce his surname correct, Auchumwa.
Oh,
Mau. Auchumau. Yeah, because in Khoisan, remember, with the language, when it comes to vowels, when it's diphthongs, you have to pronounce each vowel individually.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, his surname is Au Chu Mau.
Okay, yes. Okay.
So, he was a chief, a Khoi chief by then, and she was the niece. Because she was so bright, and the young say the white people saw that, Jan van Riebeeck them saw that, she became like the interpreter for them, between them and the Khoi people.
Yes,
because by then the Khoi people couldn't speak Dutch.
Yeah.
But she was so clever, she easily caught up the language and she became the interpreter between them. And she was used as the first interpreter and then the negotiator also between them and the Khoi people,
yes,
the Europeans and the Khoi people. Remember, they used to give the Khoi people exchange like myrrh for a sheep or myrrh for a cow, you know.
Yeah,
they used to give our people less valuable things while they were taking valuable things from us.
Yes.
So,
yes,
Krutua was the mediator, we can say. And she was also the first indigenous South African to be baptized as a Christian.
Yes.
They gave her the name Ifa. They gave Krutua the name Ifa because they didn't want her always, and they also changed her attire. She used to wear the Khoisan attire. So the wife of Jan van Riebeeck said, no man, you can't be dressed like this in the castle. So they changed, they gave her this European clothes to wear.
Yes, yes, the Dutch clothing.
Yes, yes. So Krutua was also the first interracial. She had the first interracial marriage with a doctor, Van Meerhof.
There we go.
Yeah, so she had children with him.
Yes.
And later on, the Dutch people decided to transfer him somewhere else and later told her he passed on. So for her, it was, she had a breakdown. She became like an alcoholic by then. They took her kids away. They took everything away from her. And Krutua was also the first, one of the first people to be present in Robben Island.
There we go.
So yes, she underwent so many things with the white people, with the Dutch people by then. You know, she stood firm. She stood firm in where she come from and where she wanted to be.
Yes,
she was actually supposed to get married to a certain Harry, and then she ended up marrying this doctor. And there's also some documents that prove that she was raped by Jan van Riebeeck, the first one to impregnate her. And then they forced her to have like an abortion.
Yeah.
So, yeah those were things that never got documented. You understand?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. So that is very interesting. And if I look at When Jan van Riebeeck in 1652 came to Cape Town and found Gretuwa here, she was about 13 years old.
She was
old.
13, a child.
Yeah, so if you say 1652, so she was born in 1639.
Yes.
If you do the maths correctly, 1652 minus 13 gives you 1639. So the mid 17th century. So she was a notable figure in the Khoi Khoi people, the Khoisan people at that time. And what she, as you rightfully said, and also in my research, I came to the realization that she was a notable woman. Mm. She was a clever girl. Mm. She was intellectually, she was clever and understood and picked up the language very quickly. And she had the ability to negotiate, yes, which means, yes, she was a leader in her own right. Mm. She had leadership qualities and she could stand before the settlers, which is Jan van Riebeeck and them, and she could also stand in front of her own people and speak to them. Being a woman, that to me stood out, that being a woman with such great leadership acumen, and to go forth and speak to foreigners in their own language.
In their own language, yes.
To say what the indigenous people of the country says and how they can negotiate and what they will do, etc., etc. But what is also interesting is the fact that she got married.
Yes, to one of them.
To one of them.
Mm. She got married to one of them.
And then I want to say the following, Jennifer, that was the start of the South African Rainbow Nation.
Mm.
Because if you look at, yes, he died and then they took everything away from her because they were embarrassed about this whole thing of this interracial marriage and that is where your under the apartheid laws, that is where it comes from. They still brought it there. But bringing her to a breakdown and taking her children away from her and raising them in the castle under the Dutch laws and regime and culture. And there are significant families that we can say. And I can, from the top of my head, I can just remember one. Maybe you can have more, but Peltzer.
Mm.
Peltzer is not just a clean race. Peltzer has their origin from the marriage of Gretuwa and Van Meerhof.
Van Meerhof. Yes.
Mm. This German doctor that she got married to. So, people must know these things, that this was actually the birth.
Mm.
And I mean, she traveled to Madagascar with him. She traveled all around the world with this doctor. And then later on, he was banished to Robben Island to keep her out of the public eye.
She was banished.
Yes. Yeah. To keep her out of the public eye, from all the other people that now come to Cape Town, the French and so on. So that was the start.
Mm.
That was the start, and that is how she influenced.
Mm. Yes, we can say they used her. After using her, they just tossed her away.
That's right.
And you know, and for her to be imprisoned, she couldn't see her children. Her children was taken. For any mother, it's a painful situation.
Yes.
The thing that she went through.
That's
you
right.
Know, her husband was taken away or sent away. We don't know for sure whether he was he passed on already. The only thing they brought back was his clothes.
Yeah.
So that broke her. It really broke her because when they sent him away, she wasn't able to go with him. And I mean, he was a doctor.
That's right.
He was a doctor, but for them, he went to fight somewhere in the army. You know?
My word.
So yeah, she was misled. We don't know whether he really died or was it just for them, you know, not to let her see her husband and children.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so effectively the Dutch people used and abused Gratua.
Yes.
But she shaped,
yes,
the future of South,
yes,
Africa.
Oh yes.
And this is what I want to say. One of the notable figures in the Khoisan history is Gratua.
Yes.
And as you rightfully said, she was also named Eva. Because
yes,
Gratua, we don't know if Gratua was her real name.
Gratua was her real name.
Was it
the
real
but
name?
For the Dutch people, yes, that was a Khoisan name. But
okay,
the Dutch people preferred to give her an English name.
Yes, yes,
yes. Because remember, there were a lot of other Dutch people coming from other countries. So for them to introduce her as Gratua, they had to explain the name. So they just felt, let us say she's Eva and
there,
you know,
we
they'll
go.
They'll accept that.
That's right, yes. That's right. That's right. So, viewers and listeners on the app, Gratua's life story illustrates that often overlooked contribution of indigenous people in the historical narrative dominated by colonial perspective. We make so much of the colonial history and that we forgot the actual history of South Africa.
Mm.
And we need to understand that we are from that nation. We need to, everyone in South Africa need to understand that the Khoisan people was the first nation of South Africa, of Southern Africa, and all the other nations that are here now came. They were settlers. Everyone else were settlers, except
the
Khoisan people.
Oh, yes.
But in the spirit of being a rainbow nation, and in the spirit of reconciliation, and in the spirit of Ubuntu, we embrace everybody.
Mm.
We embrace everybody because South Africa is a land for everybody.
Mm.
If you rightfully birth here and being a South African, you from the soil, no matter what your color, creed, or race, or whatever is, and I think I am of the persuasion that we should not speak about race anymore. We should speak about the South African nation, and that is it, because we are one nation. It's only on the sports field that we really come to the fore. That we are one nation. But when we retreat to our different abodes, we become diverse and fragmented again and in our silos, and that is where we're looking it from. But we need to embrace the First Nation rightfully.
Oh, yes.
And that is why we speak about that. We will go on to a music break, and we will have Pieter van der Westhuizen sing to us Blompot van die Vlei. Now, yes, the Khoisan people are the people of the soil. It's farming people. It's people from that look at the herbs and the plants of the field. So Pieter van der Westhuizen, sing to us, brother, Blompot van die Vlei.
Radio Eerste Rivier, onze stasie, onze talent, onze mensen. WhatsApp ons bij 064-536-9095. Talk to us, die ding ruk hier.
O blompot van die vlei, my blompot van die vlei, kom sit by my, o ding, ek wil vir jou een liedjie sing. My hart is aan die brand, my hart is aan die brand. Jou ma sê nie, jou pa sê ja, by my kan jy maar klaar. Ek weet jy's lief vir my, ek weet jy's lief vir my. Al slaat jou ma my op my gat, ek kom terug om jou te vat. Vir my laat ek nie blof, vir my laat ek nie blof. Jy dink ek kan kom tol, jy lieg, ek is reeds lang al vol. Ek is geen kindse maat, ek is geen kindse maat. Maar gee my net een bol, ek skop om laat. Hy tol, my ma's een kleikie sop, my ma's een kleikie sop. Dit maak van my een korrelkop, ek het lang reeds uitgedop. Jou brood het aangebrand, meisie kind, jou brood het aangebrand. Jou koffie is maar flow, maar met jou wil ek nog trouw. Jou doekie met die knop, daai doekie met die knop. Jou wegstap en jou hippe swaai, laat als hier om my draai. Van die dal, my boklam van die dal. Hoe sê jy nou, o ding, kan ek jou alleen bemin? My blompot van die vlei, my blompot van die vlei. Kom sit nou maar by my, vir ewig aan my sê. Die rare rare ra, die jare jare ra, jare 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 ra. Da 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 da.
Hierdie week vir Wiele Twee Wiele gaan rits ek rond met die nuwe Fortuneo bussie. En dan beweeg ons oor na ons eerste padtoets en dit is met die Citroen C3 e-cross. Dan oor na ons tweede padtoets en dis met die Mazda CX-60, maar spesifiek daai 3.3 liter diesel. Maar dan julle vir twee wiele.
Dit is nou die BMW GS-Driver wat in die gang is en ek ry met die selde fiets, die GS-1300.
En dit is alles waarna jy kan uitsien tydens Wiele Twee Wiele, maar tot dan toe.
Hou daai wiele aan die rol.
Yes, you are back on the couch with Doc and we are still having this interesting conversation about the Khoisan heritage according to the Khoisan people. So we exploring, we spoke about who are they, we spoke a little bit about Gratua. I mean if we should speak and go into the depths of the history, we will sit here, I don't know until when. But we need to cover a great deal of information in this 2 hours so that you can understand who the First Nation was and also let us embrace that. We know that God will bless you. Thank you, Michael, for watching. And then also Desiree Damas say, I'm Morning Doc and Jennifer. My namesake, I'm looking forward to an insightful program, and I hope it's been insightful thus far. Jennifer, now we spoke about a little bit about the Khoisan people, where they fit into the heritage. We spoke about the significance of Gratua and everyone said, and I just want to come back. I'm just reminded of this now. Just come back to Gratua quickly before we go on. It's so significant And you must help me here. It's so significant as to she was banished to Robben Island and being pushed away and so on. But when she died, where was she buried?
Doc, I believe she was buried back home. They sent her back, her body back to her family.
Yes.
So, which was here in Cape Town.
Yeah.
Yes.
But wasn't she then exhumed and buried in the Castle of Good Hope?
I won't say that. I won't say a thing that I don't know of.
I can be mistaken, but that is what I read somewhere in my research. I think if I'm not mistaken, on Wikipedia, I read that her bones were exhumed and she was buried at the Castle of Good Hope. If that is true, let's hypothetically, we don't want to speculate, but in the hypothesis of everything, let us hypothetically speaking say she was buried back at the castle.
Mm.
If that is true, that actually staking the claim that she is indeed the historian of note, the mother of the nations, and I'm not going to say the mother of the Khoisan nation, but she is indeed
the mother of the nations
or the people of Southern Africa. Because I would say from her loins, from her womb, was birthed the Rainbow Nation.
That's 100% correct. Yes.
From her womb was birthed
the Rainbow Nation.
Rainbow Nation. And I was looking at and just this is just on a side note. I went to bed last night and I put in the search on YouTube the Khoisan people and there was a narrator and telling the story of the Khoisan people. Okay, right, it's what I read and researched and so on and so forth. And but then he meticulously also describe the features
of Krutua.
Of the Khoisan people.
Oh, okay.
The features of the Khoisan people.
Mm.
And maybe it's going to shock some people today. And lo and behold, what popped up. And if you look at Tata Mandela, the same features as the Khoisan people.
But Doc must remember, Madiba came out saying he is from the Khoisan people. Yes, he was Khoisa, but he is also from the Khoisan people. So the Khoisan are part of his
ancestry.
Ancestry, yes, yes.
And that, to me, is profound. That, to me, that Madiba acknowledged.
Yes, openly.
Openly. That his roots.
Yes.
And I think we all need to, before we go into the next part where we would look at the different tribes and so on and so forth, but we actually need to embrace that.
Oh, yes.
We need to take a leave from his book to say, yes, I am. As I sit here, I am not afraid to say, yes, I am Khoisan.
Oh, yes.
I have Basotho blood inside of me. I have Dutch blood inside of me. I have German blood inside of me. Because the Albertine family is the Albertine name in essence, if we go into that, is firstly German. Two brothers of royal descent had a quarrel, like Harry and William. Harry is now in America. William stayed in Britain. So the one Albertine stayed in Germany, and the other one
came to South Africa.
No, first went to the Netherlands.
Okay.
And from the Netherlands he came to South Africa in the late 1600s. So he was part of the settlers that came. And here we are. So I'm not afraid to acknowledge and embrace that. That is why when I did my research on the Khoisan history and heritage, etc., I was elated to find out that really we are actually of the soil.
We are.
The original soil.
Indeed.
Die rooi sand van die Kalahari. Dis waar ons vandaan kom. Ons afstammelinge, ons voorouers. But there are also other bits and pieces
Not just in the Kalahari. Remember, like I say, Cape Town. When Jan van Riebeeck them came, they didn't go as far as the Kalahari at first.
Yes.
They came here to Cape Town.
Just
and
came
this
here.
Is where they found Kretua and her family.
That's right.
That was here.
Yeah.
Yes. Not in the inland. Most of the people that were chased to the inland was due to them wanting to take over
South Africa.
And they saw, you know, that South Africa is a rich country.
That's
it's a
right,
rich
yes.
land.
Yeah.
And they decided we want to stay here.
That's
because
right.
we want to become rich. And they later discovered that Kimberley's got diamonds, Joburg's got gold. There's so much other things in South Africa that they can enrich them.
Themselves, yeah.
Yes, yes. And you know, there's one thing, Doc, that I just want to mention.
Yes.
I know we're moving to another topic.
No. It's fine. We opening up the conversation.
The Dutch people wanted to kill all the Khoisan people. So what they planned, they brought blankets, and these blankets.
These
blankets were filled with
chicken pox.
Chicken pox.
Yes.
And they gave it to our people because for them it was like something to make them warm.
Yeah.
And some of our people discovered, but this is the things that's killing our people because they saw, but why are our people dying?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
they discovered, but it's this blankets that were given by the Dutch people.
That's right.
So they came here with a motive to kill all the people of South Africa, all the Khoisan people.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
rightful owners of the land.
That's right.
They felt that, no man, we don't want to negotiate with this people. We want this land.
Yeah, we actually want to take it.
We want to take it. And that is how some of our people fled to the
Kalahari, yes.
Yes, to the Kalahari. Not just the Kalahari. When we speak about the Northern Cape, some fled to the Eastern Cape,
they
actually all over South Africa today.
Yeah.
But mostly because they feared for their lives.
That's right.
They saw the dirty plan that the Dutch people
had. That's right,
had.
Yes.
Yes, and Dr. Ed, you are so, so right. When we look at the Khoisan people, yes, as you said about Kretua, yes, she brought forth the Rainbow Nation.
Yeah.
So we also exist from being like our fathers. My grandma is a Griqua.
Uh-huh.
She's a Griqua lady from Kuruman.
Yeah.
You know, that's where the Griqua people are. Let me say the Afrikaans Griqua.
Yeah.
Kuruman, Kimberley, those places. And she was from there.
Yeah.
And you know, as you said, when I was young and I went to make an ID, I actually lost my birth certificate and I applied for a shortened birth certificate. And on it was written Griqua.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, the first time I saw it, because you know these things were not discussed with us.
Yes.
Our parents didn't tell us. I was so heavily upset. Remember, I was in high school.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Now I see, because by then you were proud Cape Coloured.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And today it's a swearing word.
Yeah.
But by then, here on my birth, Griekwa. But my brothers and sisters are Cape Coloureds. How can I now be a Griekwa? You know, and I went back the second time, and it was again, say the first and second time it was white. Now they picked up my surname is Visser.
Uh-huh.
Remember my grandma's surname was Diedrichs.
Yes.
But her husband, she married a Dutchman
yeah.
who was Visser.
Yes.
Now this Visser surname was most just white people by then. So when they saw Visser, they first stated, I'm white.
Sure.
And I knew it's apartheid during the apartheid era. If I go along with this Visser birth certificate stating that I'm white, I'm going to be in prison.
Yes.
I went back twice. It was the same. The third time it was Griekwa. And I was like, you know, I kept quiet. I didn't even want to tell my friends because by then it was Griekwa.
Yeah.
No,
yeah,
I was like, you know, the Griekwa,
embarrassing.
You had that Busman people with
yes,
the
yes.
ting ting hey, and you thought, nee man, ik is Griek. You know, today I'm so proud. I'm so proud. And I said to myself, wow, if only we were taught by then, this is who we are.
That's right.
This is our
heritage.
Our heritage. It's for us to be proud of. And, you know, thinking back, just telling yourself, so many times we were told, tjala klierlinge.
Yeah, yeah.
Eti a culture.
Yes. Yeah,
you
yeah.
understand? And we were so saddened by these words.
Yes.
How can people say, ons het 'n kultuur? So now when we really discovered who we are, we now realize that, no, we are the ones with culture.
That's right.
Every other person borrowed the culture issue from us.
Exactly.
They were taught by the Khoisan people. And even the traditional healers of the other clans, say the Sotho's and so, most of them were taught by the Khoisan people.
That's right.
The medicines, they came to the Khoisan people to teach them medicine.
Yeah.
So what does it say? Our people know the soil because they are
from
the
soil
of this earth.
Yes, we are unpacking this thing. We are unpacking this thing. Exciting stuff. Exciting stuff. And we are doing it here, right here on Radio East River. Ons tasie, ons talent vir ons mense. And we are bringing this program to you. And I want to say, if you're listening there and you a businessman or you have a business and you want to sponsor this program, you can contact the station and so that we can be able to bring more and more programs like this to our people and to the nation of Southern Africa, and as we are here on Radio East River. And if you want to send us a voice note, you can use the WhatsApp message 064-536-9095 and we will respond to you accordingly. Now, Jennifer, every nation have different tribes. What are the different tribes that you can say is there within the Khoisan community?
Okay. Doc, the Khoisan people, remember I said we have the Griekwa, the
Khoi,
the San, the Nama, the Kurana, and the Bushman.
Yes.
Now, under these, the same like Tswana, Sotho, Pedi,
that's right.
Xhosa,
yes, yes.
The Xhosa people have the Nguni, they have the, you know, different tribes. So, the same with the Khoisan.
Yes.
Now, the different tribes, there's so many different tribes. And lately, it's like it's growing. But I'll just mention like a few.
Yes.
If we look at Cape Town.
Yes.
Just Cape Town.
Cape Town area.
When
yes.
we look, we have And now we have, I have to first teach you. When they write it with an X, in Khoi it's pronounced a G.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
It's Kham instead of the Xhosa, Kham.
Oh, okay.
The Xhosas will say Kham, but in Khoi we say Kham.
Kham, yes?
Yes, so we have the Khamka Ke.
Khamka Ke.
Yeah.
Khamka, right.
Actually Ke. It's a click.
Okay.
Right. Then you have the Kurana, you have the Hesekwa, you have the Kohokwa, you have the, it's a lot, the Changukwa.
Yes, yes. Now, if you, I'm sorry if I interject and, yes. and come in here. Now, it's just for the perspective of the listeners.
Yes.
And the viewers out there. Now, if you drive down the N1, you get to Liu Khamka.
Yes.
Now, these are where you get the Hesekwa area.
Yes.
That's
mostly where the Hesekwa tribe.
There we go.
Yes.
There. I want to show the listeners that when they see these names
then they
need to understand and know that this is the area where the Khamka tribe concentrated. Yes. The Hesekwa tribe concentration was in that area.
That is right. Something interesting. You mentioned Liu Khamka. Now, do you know Liu? It's a lion.
Yes.
Khamka,
yes.
Kham, it's also lion.
Yes.
Which means the name, they've double named it. Liu.
If
you say it in Afrikaans.
Yes.
Liu Kham.
Yeah.
It's the same.
It's lion.
Lion.
Yes.
Yeah. So you get that. Then you get the Namakwa. Namakwa is also a tribe.
Yes, in the west coast. Yes. Up the west coast.
Yes. Going to the Namakwa land.
Wuppertal.
Yes.
Glen William, area is there.
Now, then you get the Kami Moon. That's also Kami.
Yeah, Kami Noon.
Moon. It's two clicks.
Yes.
So it's Kami Moon.
Okay.
That's also a tribe. Now that tribe, you'll see, you get it more to the, to Namibia side.
Yes.
You get that one. Then going into, from Cape Town, moving to, like the border, Namibia border, South Africa border, you get the Karakekan.
Oh, Karakekan.
Yeah. So, in different, then you get the Kurana. Now, the Kurana, if you look at the land card, you'll see that the Kurana, most of them, when you go from Cape Town traveling, let me say more like to the Free State, the border, Free State, Eastern Cape.
Yes.
You get the Kurana clan there.
Okay.
You get the Kurana clan there. Then when you travel upper, this is the side, Free State, inland.
Yes, that's more towards the Northwest Province.
Yes. You get the Batlaro.
Okay.
That's also tribes. So in Cape Town, this is where you have the most clans.
Yes.
In Cape Town, if you look at the Western Cape, you get the Hesekwa.
Yes.
Remember I said Hesekwa. You get the Korinkwana.
Korinkwana, yeah. Korinkwana. That is what, yes.
And then you get the Gorogokwa. You get the Damanakwa. All these other tribes.
Sure. So most of the Khoisan tribes was concentrated basically in the Western Cape.
They reside in the Western
Cape. In the Western Cape. Yes. There's a few that was in the inland towards the Free State and towards Namibia side.
And then you get the rest in the Eastern Cape.
And then
we also have in the Eastern Cape.
Yes, we also have the Khoisan tribes.
Then the Griqua.
Yeah.
The Griqua. We have the Griquas here in the Western Cape.
Yeah.
Then we have the Griquas, most of them, in Northern Cape.
Yeah.
The Griquas, and then we have Griquas also in the Free State. We have Griquas also in Transvaal.
In your Gauteng.
Gauteng province.
Gauteng
yes,
province.
Yes.
Yeah. So speaking of which, that the most concentrated population of the Griqua was around Griqua Stad.
Yes. Yes.
Now that is why you have
the Griqua Stad.
Griqua Stad. Yes. Is there.
Remember, when we speak about Griqua Stad, we're not just concentrating on the that city, Griqua Stad.
Yeah, but it's the it's whole area.
The whole area. And Kimberley is also like, and that is why it's still called Griqua Land West.
There we go.
Yes,
Griqua yeah.
Land West, there
we
the
go.
Whole area.
There we go. That yes. is what we, and people of our age will know that previously on the news, they spoke and in rugby circles
yes.
we
and
had
soccer.
Yeah
yes.
we had Griqualand
Griqualand
West rugby team was going to play. Aletta Boostander says yes, we're still using Bosch's medicine when we are children. Our children are sick most probably. We still use Bosch's medicine. Yes, yeah. It is important that we use that.
Yeah.
Jennifer, some interesting point here, that in every tribe there is either a hierarchy of governance. How was the Khoisan people governed?
Okay. Remember the government did not acknowledge the Khoisan people. It's only during Madiba's time, the previous government didn't recognize the Khoisan
at all.
So currently, there is some negotiations between the Khoisan people and the current government.
Yes.
Mostly, it started when it was Zuma, President. The former President Zuma,
yes.
Jacob Zuma, he was all about the Khoisan people. And everything went like,
Bear shape.
But there is negotiations. There was also this bill that government wrote on behalf of the Khoisan people, but not consulting with the Khoisan people. So we went to this negotiations in parliament.
Yeah.
And the Khoisan people felt if you want to make bills or anything, write any documents on our behalf, include us.
Yes.
So these
which is right.
Yes. The Khoisan people were not included. They were just invited to come and sign off something that wasn't even
negotiated or discussed.
Oh yes. So that is where it ended, because there was this fightings where certain, I'm not going to mention now, certain people felt, no, they agree with government. Yes, with good reason, they are part of government.
Yes,
the people
yes.
that said, yes, it's okay. But most of the Khoisan people felt, why must we sign for something that you didn't even speak to us about? You didn't consult us. You just wrote this document. How do you know how we as Khoisan people feel
yes.
about certain issues?
That's right.
You know, yes.
And just to come in on that score again, it is again a matter of the Khoisan people are being bamboozled, and the Khoisan people is being taken for a ride, if
yes.
I can say it. The first settlers that came here in 1652, that is what they did. They used and abused the Khoisan people, and then pushed them into the Kalahari and inland, taken their land, stole their land, etc., etc. And everyone else that comes afterwards that realizes that the Khoisan people is actually the founders and the nation, the founding nation of Southern Africa. Everyone politically wants to do the same thing as the settlers,
exactly,
because they want to. Push the Khoisan people one side, wrote a bill on their behalf, and then,
Want the Khoisan to sign off.
Yes,
bill.
And if you sign it away, you can sign away your entire historical right and claim to Southern Africa.
And the future of our children.
Precisely. So it is important for us to understand that. What I want to ask you is, as much as the governments of the day, et cetera, et cetera, does not want to acknowledge it, how was the Khoisan as a tribe? In their own tribe, how did they govern themselves?
Okay, remember the different tribes had kings or chiefs. So within that tribes, there will be a chief chosen. But currently, when you say this is king, this and this, that must be a bloodline king.
Yes,
bloodline king meaning. From the father's side, from the mother's side, both needs to be Khoisan. If I take the Griqua people, if we go back to the Adams, Adam, the Boer, these people, you get also Messalaren, but all these people come now from the Griquastad, Kimberley area.
Yes.
So if in a family there's like the mother and the father are both from royal families, as they say, then a royal king or chief will be selected from that clan. And that chief will rule. But lately, you get a lot of people claiming to be chiefs. Now the only thing is they are bloodline chiefs, bloodline kings, which is the same like the Khoisans, they have bloodline where you can trace them back to, you know, like which year or whatever. So if you married a lady who's also from a royal family, then and you are from a royal family, and then say if you're the eldest but you are not interested, but you have siblings under you who's interested to become the chief, then you speak, you negotiate between the two of you.
Yes. Yeah, so abdicating your right as a chief to your sibling.
Yes. But then it must be in agreement.
It must be in agreement.
In agreement.
Yes. Yeah.
Not you just go on your own. So the other clans, the same. You understand? One can't just go and say, I'm a chief, I'm a king, I'm this, I'm that. Now, then you get under the chiefs. You get your headmans. You get your head women.
Yeah.
Now, you have to go through a process also to become a headman and a headwoman.
Yeah.
There's the ngao.
Yeah.
Now, the ngao is a ceremony where you get rewarded to become a headman or a headwoman under a chief, which means you become the board. So you will, together with the chief, make decisions.
Okay.
Upon, concerning your
clan.
Your clan.
So if you say the chief is there, the chief is like the king or the overhead
overseer,
and then you have your headman. Say for instance, there's 12 headmen that or 6 headmen that rules with him.
Yes.
So they sit and they talk about the clan. They look at what is best for the clan, and they make decisions and then also speak to the people.
Yeah, but let me just put emphasis on. Remember, the chiefs comes under the paramount chief.
Okay, so there's a paramount chief.
There's a paramount chief, which means the paramount chief is on top. Then you get your chiefs. You can have one paramount chief. Then you can have 10 chiefs under him.
Yes.
Which means the paramount chief is the ruler residing in one area. Then the rest of the chiefs can reside in other areas. But under that chiefs, there will be like headmen and headwomen supporting that specific chief in his area. But the instructions comes from the paramount chief.
From the paramount chief. What is interested? What is interested in this whole authoritative composition is that you you talk about headmen and headwomen.
Mm.
Now I want to ask the question, where did this thing come that women needs to be emancipated when in the Khoisan history, women was already, if I can call it, authoritative figures in leadership.
And they were recognized.
Yes. If you look at Gretua,
yes.
Gretua was yes. a recognized yes. leader
mm.
in amongst her people.
Yes, yes.
And she stood tall.
Mm. Yeah. Remember, with the Khoisan people, certain jobs were only for a male, certain were for a female.
Yes.
Like hunting.
Yes.
Hunting was the job of a male.
That's right.
The lady or the female was supposed to take care of
the children and the household.
But it did not withheld them from, you know, like consulting with a female. You know, they'll go out hunting, they'll bring the food, but there will always be this
conversation.
Yes, conversation between the male and the female. And, you know, we'll come to that, but something beautiful for me. You know, yes, the Western people claim to brought the Bible. That's good. It's fine.
Yes.
But they did not bring God. God was already here. Why am I saying this? Our people, our Khoisan people, when they woke up in the morning, they prayed.
Yeah.
When they went hunting, they prayed.
Yes.
Before they ate, they sat down, they prayed. Before they went to bed, they prayed. You understand? So, for our people, yes, it may not have been the words that the Dutch people brought, but in their language, they spoke to God. They had a close relationship with God. So, some people would have said, yeah, they are bushmen. They don't pray. These people were so close to God. For them to, you know, move in the mountains, move wherever the valleys, they spoke to God. They had a close relationship with God.
Yeah, because they were in nature.
Oh, yes.
They were in the creation.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
You know, they were in the creation. Oh, yes. And they understood
yes.
that a higher being, a higher
yes.
order
mm.
was at play here.
Exactly.
Nothing did exist
yes.
if it was not for a higher order and yes. a mighty hand.
Oh, yes.
And that is in their own humble way, if yes. I can call it that, they connected with this higher being.
Oh yes,
you know, and yes. That is profound. That is so profound, and it is also good to know that each group has its own unique traditions mm-hmm. and ways of life, but shared a common heritage of hunter-gatherers
yes.
Practice. The San are also renowned for their rock art,
mm.
Which provide insight into their spiritual beliefs and social life, depicting a rich tapestry of their interaction with the environment and with each other, and as you said, with God.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
And that is so profound. And we're going to explore a little bit more of this when we actually came to the real thing that this is all about, the language. We need to get to the language part. But we're going to go on to a music break. And we will listen to Pieter Van der Westhuizen again, but let me just read, here's another comment from Benny Stallenberg. He says, the Khoisan people also protect them against the Portuguese with animals in the year 1510. Mm-hmm. So there's another little bit of history that comes from our listeners that, and viewers that's tuning in, and we say thank you for your contribution. Kupatika, chuchichu is what Peter van der Westhuizen is going to sing to us. Let's take a listen as we will go after that. We will go into the story of the history of the Khoisan language. Don't go away.
The Butcher's Market, looking for incredible value? Explore our fantastic range of products here at TBM at Sanbury Square on the corners of Baden Powell Drive and Old Forty Road for your halal meats.
Sit maar aan, kom vat de broek. Tjoetje tja, tjoetje tjo, die eel te pla, maar weer voor een tuur. Kijk daar ver, kijk daar door, die stof zo ver kan oor die vloer. Wat zou ik draaien? Dus mensen van Toekazeda. Koepetika, koepetiko, kom zet maar aan, kom vat de broek. Tjoetje-tja, tjoetje-tjo, die eel te pla, maar weer voor een tuur. Ons leen, hier word die man sê net die kan. Hoe gaan het ons zwaar, wanneer is die daar? Ja, die oneef, ek's nog op dreef. Koepetika, koepetiko, kom sit maar aan. Kom vat de proef. Tjoetje-tja, tjoetje-tjo, die eel te pla, maar weer voor een tuur. Koepetika, koepetiko, kom zet maar aan, kom vat de proef. Tjoetje-tjo, die eel te pla, maar weer voor een tuur.
Fumaneka bantu siyafumaneka guys inombolo yethu ngu 064 536 9095.
Yes, you are back with us on the couch with Doc, and I hope and believe and trust that this program is, has been insightful to you, and that you have received much needed eye-opening, mind-blowing information this morning, and that you now can embrace your Khoisan heritage. And as we're going to explore a little bit more on the side with my guest Jennifer, that is in the studio with me this morning. So yes, Jennifer, historically the Khoisan language is the oldest language in Southern Africa. But being the oldest language, it's also the most marginalized language, I would nearly say, in the world. And less recognized. It's not part of the 12 languages of South Africa, or the 11 official languages. Braille is the 12th language because people need to acknowledge that. But the original language, the foundational language of which all the other languages stems from, is not recognized.
Absolutely.
You went and study the language first and foremost. For me, was it difficult?
Doc, yeah, let me say, it's if you start to learn the language, we call it Kwekwe Kuvap language, it is a little difficult, especially if you've never, spoken like any other language, especially Xhosa. When you know a few words in Xhosa, then it will be easier because of the clicks.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
If you, like myself, I can speak Tswana, Sotho, Sepedi, I can speak, so for me, but Xhosa, yes, I learned Xhosa a little bit, so it was a little easier. So when I started at Stellenbosch University, Dana Bradley van Sitters was the one who taught us there. And then later on, he went to UCT.
Yes.
And then, yes, I was also opportune to go there to study. He was also the one teaching us.
Yeah.
So then, after him, we got an opportunity to study the language after graduation. They looked at the first class. I was the second class.
Yes.
So from the first class, they selected one person to study, a lecturer. For lecturer, one person in the first class, one in the second. So myself, as I said last time, and Tanel, the two of us were selected from the two groups to be lecturing the language. So we studied with Mr. Dosap. We call him Meester.
Yes, yes.
Because in Khoisan, we need to say Kwasap.
Kwasap.
Kwasap, Kwasap. But now he then taught us later on, you could say Meester. Meester was now like for a teacher.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So teachers were addressed. So we called him Meester Dosap. He's very, very good in the language. He has written books in the Khoi language. Even this little booklet, he wrote it. He made DVDs for people to study. The Khoi language. So yes, and then after that, we, myself and Tanel, were given an opportunity to teach the language. So we had two different classes running. Mm-hmm. All the people did it online. The second class was supposed to be vibrant, but then we also gave the class online because most of the
people.
Students preferred to be taught online since they were all over South Africa, Namibia. We had students from Namibia.
Yes, yes.
That is how I got into studying the language and being part of the language teaching program.
Okay. Great stuff. Now, take us through some of the... Give us some lessons.
Okay.
There's the people. The people are sitting on Facebook and on TikTok. Come on.
Okay.
Give us some lessons with regards to how do you say good morning?
Okay.
How do you say good day and afternoon and so on? How do I say? Because to me, when I was first introduced to the Tswana people in ministry, for me, it was when you can greet people in their own language,
yes,
and say something in your in their language, mm, then you are half,
won their trust.
You won their trust, yes, immediately.
Yes.
And I quickly on stage I had to just ask,
How do I greet the people?
And how do I say this? And so on. So yeah, when I went up to preach my first sermon, yeah, I went up there and I greeted the people. Dumelang kalipitso la Jesu. Jesu kemorena.
Amen.
And it was pandemonium. So let's,
amen,
let's do that for, okay, us.
I had to mention a couple of things, right? So the Khoi people, when they start like a meeting or a prayer meeting or something,
yes, yes,
they don't shout, come on, if people are standing outside, come on, people, we want to start. No, they just start singing,
yes,
Sida, Sida, Gera, Tswa, Tswa, which means, come on, people, let us start.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
yes, they'll be singing Sida, Sida, Gera, Tswa, Tswa. Now, the first thing I want to do before I continue with the language, I want to pray the morning prayer.
Okay, great stuff, great, okay, stuff. People of Cape Town, people of East River, our listeners, our viewers, we're going to pray the morning prayer, and Jennifer is going to do that in, okay, the Khoi San language. All let's right, take a listen.
Okay, so when you say, let us pray, you say, Ada Torere. Let us pray.
All right.
Ada korere. Now the morning prayer will be Kwas Kores.
Uh huh.
Kwas is for morning. Then in the afternoon, remember I said Tses. It's Tses. And in the evening, it will be Kwes. Right. So now the morning prayer Ada korere. Kwas Kores. Gangansi abotsi ni suhup katsko. Kuida kais karuma. I tohoba netis unga sao dare. Now, if you heard me speaking through my nose, that is the Khoi San language. That is the vowels. So in Khoi San, we have four clicks, four vowels. Now, the four clicks, like I said, the Xhosa people borrowed three. You have the one stripe, which is called the dental click. Then you have the two stripes, which is called lateral clicks.
Okay.
But it's the long stripes. Mm-hmm. It must be longer than the L. Then you have the alveolar click, which is, I call it the telegraph pole. So it's one stripe through two stripes.
Okay. Right. Okay.
Now, if you use your phone, you'll be using the hashtag, but the hashtag is not the correct click. The hashtag is just, because the most phones don't have that sign.
That sign, yeah.
Yes. Then you have the what you call it? The palatal click. Now the palatal click is the, so the uitroepteken, the palatal.
Exclamation mark.
Exclamation mark.
Yes.
Now, with the exclamation mark, the click, the palatal click, it's the.
Okay.
Right. And then the dental click, the one stripe, it will go like, it's a sucking when you, something is nice, a sweet. Oh. Yes. Yes. There you go, doc. There you go.
Yes,
doc's
yes,
got
yes.
it. Now the lateral click, it's when your left side of your tongue goes to your left side of your cheek, or the right side of your tongue goes to your right side of your cheek. That you call the lateral, which is
Okay.
You know that angry sound that our parents used to make when you don't listen.
Yeah, trek je my die tanden. That type
no,
of thing.
No, not that one. The
okay.
Dikken luisterik. Yeah. Then the alveolar, it's also like a sucking. It's right. So now, then you get the four vowels. I'll now teach you more. The four vowels, it's a short vowel, like in Achap. An Afrikaans. So when I now teach you the alphabet, I had to speak Afrikaans because the alphabet is sound Afrikaans, not English. Otherwise, it won't sound right.
All right.
So then it's the long vowel. Long vowel, it's like in your Afrikaans, when you have two A's, like R tuple, next to each other. So now the long vowel, it's a stripe on top of an A or E on top of the vowel.
All right.
The vowel, it's just the A without any stripe or anything. Then you have the nasalized vowel, like when you have flu. It's a A or E or any vowel, but it comes through your nose. The sound. When I prayed, remember I said, queen. It's through my nose. Oh, yes. That sound, netsis. No, not that queen. Netsis. It's through, it's, long vowel, but the nasalized, it's queen, the kapi.
Yes.
The head on top of the vowel. Then you get the diphthong. Remember when I started, I spoke about a diphthong.
Yes.
Diphthong is where you have two vowels.
Yeah.
Next to each other. Okay. So if it's O-E, you had to say uwe.
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 Yeah.
But if it's E-O, eo.
All right. So saying it, actually pronouncing it individually.
Individually. That's the correct word.
Okay.
That's the, now with the alphabet. Let's get to the alphabet. The alphabet, there's only 20 letters, within the Khoisan alphabet.
Mm-hmm.
The normal alphabet's got 26, but the Khoisan alphabet only has 20.
Okay.
Now I'm gonna say it quickly in Afrikaans.
Yes.
It's A, B, C. Now the T replaces the C.
The C, yes.
Yes. Then it's D, E, and remember, I said the X.
Yes.
You pronounce G. Now the X, you pronounce, I said G, then it's G, ne? Then it's H, then the G, you pronounce K.
Okay.
You write it with the, you write the G,
but
you say K, not K, K. K, reason being, then the K, it's ka. Ka, ka. Then it's the key. K-H-I, key. Uh-huh. Right. Then you get the M, N, O, P, R, S, T, U, V. Not we, V. That's the alphabet. I said the C replaces the T replaces the C.
C.
Then the X replaces, the X is pronounced G.
Okay.
The G is pronounced K.
Yes.
Right. The I is E.
Uh-huh.
And then the U is we. In a word pronounced we, but you say u, but we in a word.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you
okay.
pronounce it as a diphthong. Right, now let me now teach you a few greetings. Greetings, I'll try to teach you a few how to count as well. Okay, let me quickly greet, yeah.
Let's quickly go to the greetings. How do we greet? How do we say good morning?
Right. Remember I said good morning is kai kuas.
Kai kuas.
Kai kuas.
Kuas.
Then you get the afternoon, it's kai ses. Most of the kai, people, when they meet, ses. And I need to teach you also, when we greet, you hold your hands like this, you say kai ses.
Okay.
Kuas. That's a sign of humbling yourself.
Yes.
Remember, the Khoisan people are people from the soil of this earth. Very humble people.
Very humble, yes.
Now, in the evening, we say kai kues.
Kai kues.
Now, when I ask Doc, how are you doing? I'll be saying mire. It's also nationalized.
Mire.
Yeah. Now, if you ask me mire, then I say kai a aitsama mire, which means I'm good, thanks, and you. Then you respond kai a. I'm also, you say
okay,
kai.
Okay. Nearly like, nearly English. Nearly English is I a.
Kai.
Kai a.
Remember, the pronunciation is more Afrikaans.
Because
in English you say a.
Yes.
In koi you say a.
Yeah.
Kai.
Yeah. Kai,
so that is why I said when you come to the alphabet, it's better to say it Afrikaans. English will confuse you because the words
yes,
is more
yes.
Afrikaans sound than English. Yeah, and when you say, Doc, when you ask me for something, the water,
yes.
And you want to say please.
Yeah.
Please is Tokoba.
Tohoba.
You know the old people used to gee aan toch.
Ja, ja.
Tohoba.
Ja.
But the Tohoba you spell T-O-X-O-B-A.
Okay. Okay.
Then you have the thank you. Remember I said thank you earlier?
Yeah.
Now thank you if you speak to me saying thank you, Chen.
Yes.
Then it will be Gangan Chen. But if you don't put my name, you say Gangans.
Gangans is without
just
the
Gangans
name. Gangan
without
is with the name.
Yeah, if you say thank you very much, then you say K Gangans.
Okay.
K Gangans.
All right.
Yeah. Doc, I was actually looking for something to ask you. That's why I was actually... Let me... just in short...
30 seconds.
Oh. I wanted to quickly teach you to count from 1 till 10.
Yes.
All right. 1 will be kui.
Kui. Kui. Kui.
Kui. Kam.
Kui. Kui. Kam.
Kui. Kam. It's the sucking, remember, like a sweet...
Tam.
Kui. Kam. Both of them.
Yes.
Then it's... Ngona.
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 Haka.
Haka.
Koro.
Koro.
Ngani.
Ngani.
Hmm. Nationalize.
Hmm.
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 Kaisa.
Kaisa.
Look at the mouth. Kaisa.
Kaisa.
Kwesi.
Kwesi.
This. Now, Doc, something very interesting. When you come to 10 in Khoisan and you want to count 11, as you write it 11, remember...
It's
10 plus 1.
Yeah.
Which means 10 will be DC. Now when you go to 1, 1 is kui. So it's DC kui ka.
Yeah. DC kui kwa.
No. Ka. It's a sucking.
Okay.
That's not a... It's a... lekker sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So people of the South, We need to wrap this up. I don't want to, but we have to. It's time. The time went so quickly and we can still go a long way. I just want to say, let us embrace our heritage. Let us embrace the heritage of South Africa, this one nation, this beautiful nation, as we've learned so much about the first nation of Southern Africa. And there's still much more to learn about. But for the people, for our people, we as people of South Africa, let us embrace our heritage. No matter where you come from, no matter where you stem from, just remember that there is one nation that all the nations of South Africa stems from, and that is the Khoisan nation. And let us embrace that. And let us tell that story to all our people. May God bless you. Thank you for watching. Thank you for tuning in. And she now says, I must say, she will say it. God bless you. Goodbye. And dotsins
okay.
in this Khoisan language.
Okay. When I say goodbye to Doc, I say, Kaise kure. Then Doc must say, Kaisahare,
Kaisahare.
Yes. Go well, stay well. And
Kaisahare, everybody.
We meet again, it's Kavamugus.
And Kavamugus.
Kavamugus.
So goodbye. Until next time. God bless.
Amen.
Yeah. Molweni makhaya. Singu Radio is River. Sifumaneka kuzo zonke social media platforms.
Radio East River. Radio East River. Radio East River. Radio East River.